let's start from where we were, which was crisis, to where we are now, and then talk about what you did in the interim. So how are things now?
So now I'm able to take a breath or more. So now we hired another full-time attending. We have two full-time inpatient APPs and two outpatient APPs, as well as several outpatient providers. So our staffing has grown significantly. In addition, I think every week there is 1.5 FTE attending on and two FTE APPs.
So you've doubled to quadrupled your staffing from where it was 2.5 years ago.
Yes.
Pretty remarkable. Tell me about you mentioned to me on our call maybe a month or two ago, some of the roles that you've been asked to take on that said to me that your system views you as a reliable leader and as someone who can be trusted to take on really difficult and challenging problems and shepherd them through. So could you mention some of those things?
Sure. I think, part of the great things about being in a small community hospital is that you become very visible. And so one of the things that I began doing and I continue to do is I debrief the nursing staff. So I have a summer session going right now with the ICU staff, where the nurses can debrief with me. I think COVID-19 actually really brought everything to a head. I am the co-chair of the ethics committee at my hospital. And part of that role was to align with the greater ethics consortium within our city to tackle the ventilator allocation protocols for our system. And it was through that collaboration and that role that I played, I was a leader in creating the algorithm for the ventilator allocation protocol, that I began making lots of connections throughout our system. It's very isolating being in a community hospital. You know, we're the kid's sister. I'm not at the university hospital, so nobody knew who I was. I mean, I felt like I was a leader within my own program, and I was, but outside of that small bubble, nobody knew who I was. But through this, I made a lot of amazing collaborations across the street, across the city. And then from there, crisis number two hit, which was equity and diversity within the healthcare system. And it was through this need to continue to think about the problem and tackle the problem head on that I was appointed the Associate Chair of Diversity and Inclusion at our hospital to help with the issue of racism and equity and inclusion within the Department of Medicine.
So two major national crises, one the COVID-19 pandemic and the second the recognition of what has always been there, the structural and endemic racism in our society, both not exactly easy issues to address. Somehow the fact that you were able to lead an effective palliative care program said to your colleagues that you'd be a good person to lead these two extremely challenging and difficult problems. But to me, that is a measure of the respect and regard in which you are held, and makes me proud that
yeah,
happened.
I appreciate that.
And is something, you know, that actually is starting to be a phenomenon around the country where people who have led palliative care programs are moving up in hospital and health system leadership to CMO roles and similar, and you're somewhere on that path right now as well.
Oh boy. well, I think that we bring forth our skills in communication, right? So our ability to create safe spaces very quickly, our ability to, you know, tackle a problem with no agenda and to just listen and communicate, I think is appreciated during times of crises.
Precisely. It's core palliative care skills that actually are the skills of quality leaders, now that you say it.